Alrighty, welcome to Clannad. This is a very beautiful visual novel. The reason I decided to play this was because I was hoping it could help me learn to read better and talk better. Let's begin this emotional train. Alright, the world is covered in white. Snow. Yes, it's snow. Even now, it continues to fall, coating me in its paleness. Ah, what could I be doing here? Better yet, how long have I been here? My hand is buried in snow. It's holding on to something. I pull it out. It's a pure white hand. It's a girl's hand. Oh yeah, that's right. I wasn't alone. I wipe away the snow on her face. Her profile, sleeping peacefully, appears before me. Yes. This girl and I have always been together. Here in this world. This empty, sorrowful world. I hate this town. There's just too many memories I'd rather forget. Every day is the same. Go to school, see friends, come home to a place I can't stand. Nothing new ever happens. I wonder if something will change if I keep living like this. I wonder if my life will ever change. There's nature almost everywhere you look around. I guess today is just another day trekking through the mountain to get to school. The trip would be so much easier if I could just level them all. If I were able to go in a straight line, I'd probably save myself maybe 20 minutes. 20 minutes every day. How much time would that save me in a year? I try to do the math in my head as I walk. Can't figure it out at all. I don't see any other students from my school around here. This is the main street to the school too. Normally there are students everywhere. Today isn't a vacation day or anything like that either. I guess that means I'm late. Responsible students don't stroll to school at this hour of the day, after all. Still, I continue walking at a leisurely pace, unfazed by my realization deserted scene before me. Meters left to get to school. I stand still for a moment. I exhaled dejectedly while gazing up at the sky. There stood the school gates all the way up the ridge, up in the sky. Whose idea was it to put a school at the top of this giant slope anyway? The hill goes on like a never-ending nightmare. There's another side, but much smaller and shorter than mine. I look to my right. A girl is standing there just as still as me. I can tell from the color of her school insignia on her uniform that she is also a third-year student. But she isn't someone familiar to me. Her short hair that comes just above her shoulder flutters in the wind. She seems to be on the verge of tears. As a repeat offender of late arrivals, I'm not bothered one bit, but on the other hand, she on the other hand, seems far more concerned. The idea of getting to class this late must be pretty upsetting to her. Yes. Yeah. Uh-huh. She's nodding her head up and down with her eyes closed as if telling herself something. She opens them. She stares up at the school gates. Do you like the school? Huh? Oh, she's not talking to me. She's talking to someone else. Someone in her head, I guess? I wonder how he, or she, perhaps she, replied. I really like it. But I know that sooner or later, everything changes. The fun things, the happy things, all of it. Nothing can stay the same forever.
Girl, that's pretty depressing.
She continues to talk to herself awkwardly. Even if things change, will I still be able to enjoy it here? You just have to find more, that's it. Huh? The girl looks at me, surprised. It's almost as if she thought she was alone the whole time. Then you just have to find more things that are fun. More things to make you happy. Simple as that. It can't be that hard, right? The expression on her face changes. Yes. I remember those days where I felt like what it felt like to be naive and simple. That's something we've all experienced. Come on, let's go. We start to climb the hill. The long, long hill. Sonohara. The teacher calls out a student's name. Absent as usual. I look to the side, or to my side, where Sunohara's desk is empty, sits empty. His attendance rate is even worse than mine. You see, the two of us are often labeled as the delinquents of the school. But that's probably why we get along so well. He's really the only person in class I can have an honest conversation with. Nevertheless, today's classes begin. I spend them looking out the window. The teacher's voices go in one ear and out the other. Classes finish, bringing the school day to an end. Sunohara never did show up. In fact, the only person I've spoken to all day is that girl from this morning. Really just another ordinary day. Since I'm not part of any after-school club, I grab my empty bag, cut through the pack of jabbering students, and leave the classroom. I could go home, but there wouldn't be anyone else there at this hour. Not anyone I want to see, anyway. I don't have a mother. I was told she died in a car accident when I was still little. I don't even remember what she looked like. After her passing, my father sank into a deep depression. probably due to the shock and numb. Using alcohol to numb his pain, he wasted his days gambling. Because of that, a lot of my time as a kid was spent arguing with him, actually. But one day, our relationship took a turn for the worse. He got violent with me. Ever since then, my father stopped showing his emotion. He stopped calling me just water and said calling me water coo, as if we were nothing but strangers. Indeed, he's turned into just that at this point. It's like he's retreating into some kind of shell. As if he's trying to sever the present from the past. It would be better if he'd just push me away completely, or even just keep hitting me. At least then I'd know where I'd stand with him. But no, every time he sees me back at home from school, he brightens up like an old friend visiting and starts making small talk. It hurts. It hurts so much. I can't stand being home anymore. That's why I stay out so late now. If I don't come home when I know he's asleep, I don't have to see him. It's why I go to bed at dawn, and of course, man, I don't wake up until noon. I've been late almost every day since the starting of high school. I've spent my life like this for almost 3 years now. Today is no different either. I go home just to change out of my school uniform, and I leave again before my father gets back. The routine practically feels ingrained in me at this point. Ha! There was... I wander around town aimlessly until nightfall. No matter what, I always end up at the same place. On my way back, I grab some takeout from a local restaurant. I carry it with me and walk down the massive hill from this morning towards the school dormitory. Our school pays special attention to its clubs, so a lot of students come from more rural areas to enroll. Those students then live here for the next 3 years, separated from their parents.
Ah, don't stop it!
These kids are practically members of a different species when compared to someone without any academic dreams, like me. Normally, I wouldn't have anything to do with them, but Sonohara lives here. He used to be on the soccer team and was accepted to the school because he was good. However, he lost his spot on the varsity team as a freshman after being suspended for getting into a huge fight with a student from another school. By the time the following year's squad was decided, he was already an outcast within the team. He had no choice but to leave. He doesn't have any money to move though, so he still lives in the dorms with all the jocks. How many times must I tell you? But the volume is nearly all the way down. Sonohara is standing there. He's in front of another room talking to a student about twice his size. That doesn't matter! The walls are paper thin, so I can still hear you. Listen on your headphones or something. Ah, come on, I can't afford those. Don't listen at all. But I can't get into the zone without it. Plus, I think the music's pretty cool anyway. You should listen to the lyrics next time. You'll totally think it's cool. I don't think you get it. I don't care if they're cool or not. You need to understand how pissed off I am right now. Seriously, if I hear you one more time, I'm kicking your ass straight out of here. Sonohana shakes his head, standing still in front of the now closed door. Damn it, stupid rugby players. He mumbles under his breath. He won't be able to hear you like that, you know? Damn it, stupid rugby players! Standing behind him, I repeat his words with a yell. Eek! Sonohara grabs my head and drags me into his room. I can hear an angry yells of, "Hey, who are you?" resulting from the hallway. Are you trying to get me killed? You're not the one who said that. Wait. You're the one who said that. That's right. Listen, Patterson. My relationship with those guys has been rocky at best. Lately, and I haven't been causing them any trouble. Then let's go out with a bang. I still have another year left here. Dang, you're just gonna have to live out in fear like this for the entire time. Hey now. I don't back down from one-on-one fights, even if that means fighting one of those rugby guys. But he's not the only guy on the team living here. They're all in different rooms around us. I can't make any trouble here. I'm totally outnumbered. But I guess I wouldn't mind doing something crazy right before graduation. I'll be counting on you to have my back then. Alright? Great, I'll be sure to take a shot of my own at you while I'm at it. You're supposed to be covering my back, not stabbing, eh? I'm on the rugby's team side, you know? Since when? Oh, not now, but I will be when all goes down. What? Why? Did these 2 years we spent together mean nothing to you? Really? Boom! The wall shakes. The rumble is followed by a quiet down! Eek! I'll kick the wall right back for you. No, don't! You get scared way too easily. Dude, put yourself in my shoes. And he's crying now. Please don't make any trouble for me while you're here. Sure. His pathetic display has such an impact on me, I give up without thinking.
Ah! But no!
Munch, munch. I settle down in a small area between the wall and Sunohara's ever-present kotatsu table and begin eating my dinner. Sorry, can I get some tea? You really think I'm gonna serve you tea? Hey, I said I'm sorry. I don't care if you apologize or not, you're not getting any tea from me. What do you think this is, the cafeteria? We're in your room, I understand that. Uh-huh. And you're my maid here. Yeah, you're definitely not getting any now. Please, I forgot to buy some. So is this idea of going out and buy some yourself just not registering? But I thought you wanted to do anything you could to be of service to me after I saved your life, no? What? That never happened. That's what you told me after I saved you, though. That man named Sonohara died long ago.
Ah, my nose.
Before you now stands your loyal attendant. I am but a simple tea servant. That is what you will say to me. So, tea please. That's the worst story I've ever heard. Alright, could you get me at least one cup of tea then? I'm not getting you a last cup, just like I'm not getting you a first cup. Oh, but it's such a moving story. You'll definitely want to pour me some when you hear it. Oh, God. You seemed done for after suffering your life-threatening injuries. But I, ordered you to make me some tea. So you summoned your last drop of your strength to go brew some, and you even groveled on all fours. And then, Mr. Patterson, here is your tea, sir. And this cup will be my last. You die with a smile on your face. Man, I sound so remarkably satisfied in that story. Well, it was definitely how you wished to go, after all. Nevertheless, I sat there, drinking that final cup of tea as I cried. See? Moving, isn't it? So, tea please. I already told you, no! I spent the rest of my time there reading a magazine. With no TV in the room, the only things I could really do are talk to Sonohara or read. About time to go to sleep. It was late and the date had already changed over. Yeah, I guess so. One line I didn't cross was staying the night at Sonohara's room. Just the thought of waking up in the morning to someone like that is depressing. God, my nose. Stop it. Alrighty, I'm gonna take a shower now. Okay. Sonohara grabbed some underwear and a towel from under the heap of clothes in the corner of his room before leaving. I prefer to avoid having to welcome Sonohara back to his room after a shower. So I leave while I still can. I close the magazine and get off the floor. As I do, I find myself looking at a cassette player. There's a tape still sitting inside it. I try playing it. Out comes a melody of Japanese rap song that hasn't been popular for a while. Talk about lame. Who listens to this kind of stuff anyway? We'll just leave it there. This will be the first time I don't do anything to his room after I leave. After he leaves me alone in it. But I guess I'll spare him for today. I decide to leave before Sonohara comes back. She's standing here again, just like yesterday. You again? Why can't you get up the hill on your own? Well, how can I put this? You don't have to tell me if you don't wanna. You don't even know me, after all. Oh, alright. But really, you should get to school on time. It's like a good student. But you're late for school too. She points straight at me with her eyes burning right through my thinly veiled retinas. Ah, forget about me. I look away, unable to meet her gaze any longer. What am I acting all serious getting on to her case. I don't even know her well enough. She's absolutely right, though. She's just as much as a delinquent as I am. Do what you want. I start up the hill without her. It's just... what drew me to her in the first place? That she really didn't look like a bad student. That's all. Oh, please wait. A voice. It's hers. May I join you? I look behind me to find her standing there quietly. Why? Well, I feel anxious going alone. It's kind of odd that she's asking me, of all people, someone she doesn't even know. I mean, she has to have at least one friend or two, right? I look up the hill, squinting from the sun's blinding glare. It's not too far away, and she's got no one else to go right up with right now, so I guess it couldn't hurt. Do what you want. I start walking again after repeating myself. Please, please wait. What now? The girl eyes me, looking as though she's deciding on whether to say what just popped into her head, and then... Anpan? A single word is all that came out. How am I even supposed to react to that? Baguette. I don't really understand what you mean. You took the words right out of my mouth. I was gonna ask you the same thing. So what, you like Anpan or something? Is that it? No, not particularly. But it's not as if I hate it. I guess it's more like than it is dislike. Talk about beating around the bush, it's not like I really care anyway. Alrighty, let's get going. Okay. There's a bit of a newfound energy in her response.
God knows! Damn it.
Maybe there was some kind of weird magical spell she cast just now. The thunk, the thunk, the thunk. Her footsteps make it sound like she's galloping behind me. Bell rings, ending the period. Someone calls out unexpectedly, and I turn to face the source. Oh, it's Ryu Fujibayashi, I think is how you pronounce that. She's the class president, I think. Or rather, she's the girl who is saddled with the responsibility of being the class president. If I remember correctly, she's Kyo's younger sister. I mean twin. Well, same thing. Insecurely darts her eyes left or right as she's standing next to my desk.
Yeah?
Here. She says as she hands me a sheet of paper.
A love letter?
Huh? No, it's not.
You're bolder than you look.
It's not easy just to hand me that so directly. It's not a love letter. Is it a chain letter then? It's kind of mean of you to hand me such a thing so nonchalantly. I don't think it's a chain letter either.
A letter of challenge.
Nope. Fujibayashi blushes and then presses the paper against my chest. It's the handout for this morning's homeroom.
Oh, lame. I toss it in my desk drawer without so much as even looking at it. It's probably not important anyway. Do you need something else? I think you should try to come to school on time more often. None of your concern. But, I think it'd be better if you'd come on time. So you think you can start picking on your classmates' attendance now that you're class pres? That's not it, but... Well... Her eyes start to water. I guess that was a little too mean. Kinda not my problem, though. Hey, Patterson, don't make the class pros cry, okay? Otherwise, her sister will come after you. It's not... I'm not crying. You can't even say that if you're on the verge of tears. In any case, since no tears have actually came out, let's just say she's not crying. I rest my chin on my hand and look out the window. I imply that we have nothing more to discuss. She seems to get the message and heads to her seat with her shoulders dropped. Perhaps she had something more to say. As I rest my head on the table after third period, I hear Bud coming from the seat next to mine. I look up and I see Sonoha reclining in his chair with a satisfied expression painted on his face. Oh my. Morning. What a great start to the day. Makes me want to say, bombed ahead. You ought to be thanking me. Your morning was only peaceful thanks to my generosity. Huh? What does that have to do with how nice my morning has been? You must be making stuff up again. I listened to my favorite hip-hop songs and drank my coffee. So proud of myself. And it's nice knowing that no one can put a damper on my mood in the morning. That's good to hear. I'll be sure to be merciless the next time I mess with him. I know. I'll record you a copy of my mixtape, and then you can start off your day with it too. I'm not interested in bombing any heads.
Never knows.
Making fun of the song? That you keep talking about this hip-hop mix of yours, but that song isn't even hip-hop, it's straight Japanese pop. What are you talking about? That song is the undisputed gold standard of hip-hop. We're not getting into a debate about this. Anyway, bring a tape next time and I'll make a copy. I said I don't want one. Whatever, I'm going back to sleep. But didn't you just wake up? I did, but there's no point in staying awake. You really are the unquintessential role model. Okay, good night. He rests his head on the table, unaffected by the fact that he is in the middle of a classroom trying to catch a nap. Brazen indeed. Ugh. Oh well. I nod slightly, probably caught up in his drowsiness. I look at the table ahead of me to figure out what subject fourth period is. Then a thin textbook means that thin textbook means English grammar. That teacher constantly calls on me. Screw this, I'm leaving. I leave the classroom and head over to the old building. I tiptoe my way down the hallway. Most of the classrooms aren't used anymore. They'd give a culture club one of those rooms if they applied for it, but for now, they're all just being left as is. I sneak into one room, one of the empty classrooms unnoticed. I find a chair and sit down, placing my whole weight on it. Beyond the curtainless window, I see the same sky as always. I go to the trouble of being truant, and all I do is kill time. The air of the empty room absorbs my mutters. When will my life change? Will there be a day when it will change? Someone I knew once said that. That guy must have been really effeminate, I think to myself. And then I have a sudden realization I was the one who said that. I close my eyes. How great things would be if you could fast forward time. Feeling the unrelenting sun on my face, I open my eyes. I've had enough of being in an empty room. I get up and leave the classroom. I aimlessly walk down the stairs. The sliding door hallway catches my eye. It's the library. The sign reads closed, hangs from the door. Upon closer inspection, the door is slightly ajar. It grabs my attention, though I could not say why. I open the door and step inside. Tall bookshelves and reading tables line the room. A faint breeze carries the fragments of dust of dust and paper. The curtains flow and flutter as if they're breathing. Beyond that, I see a silhouette. It's a quiet female student wearing a childish hair ornament. That emblem on her chest shows she is a third year, like me. For some reason, she's sitting on the floor. Maybe she feels sick. I walk closer and notice she isn't immersed in the book. Wait, no, she is immersed in the book. Is she playing hooky too? Sunohara and I are the only ones who'd be outside the classroom at this time of day. She doesn't notice me and continues reading. But then she suddenly stops turning the pages. She's found something. She takes out a pair of scissors. She positions the blades on a page and stops for a few seconds. It's almost as if she's meditating. And then, snip, snip, snip. She cuts through the book without any hesitation. Hey, wait! I run up to her without thinking. Huh? She stops and looks at my face. She's barefoot for some reason. Oh my god, my nose needs to stop. Yeah. Her campus shoes and socks lie on the floor. Surrounding her is a mountain of books and a bag that probably belongs to her. Now that I look more closely, there's even a cushion she brought from somewhere. Her glare and the relaxed way she's sitting make everything seem unbalanced. That book belongs to the library.
Huh?
She's thinking of something. Snip, snip, snip. Here. She cuts the corner off the page she extracted from the book and hands it to me. The ones on the end taste better. She's talking about the paper like it's a slice of cake or meat. You eat this. I accept the piece of paper, but I hold it up and question her. I do not. I am not a goat.
I thought so.
Do you want to eat paper?
I do not want to eat it either.
You're not hungry?
I'm starting to get hungry.
Me too. We're making a conversation, but nothing seems to make any sense. Anyway, I don't think it's good to cut up a school's book. It's out of character for me, but I lecture her. Snip, snip. She's not listening. Never mind. Do what you want. I drop the piece of paper and she gave me to the floor. Since I'm here anyway, I glance at the books around her. The thickest book says Astrophysics, From Past to Future on the cover. It's one of those books where I wouldn't understand a single word of it. Those books seem to be too specialized and expensive for a library like this. Looking more closely at one she's holding, it's stamped Property of the Professional Library. It isn't a school's book after all. Hey, I scratch my head. Didn't your parents tell you to take care of public property?
Huh?
She's in deep thought again. She takes a box from her bag and opens the lid.
Lunch?
Very delicious lunch.
I didn't ask.
I made it myself. Today's menu is a rolled omelet with a soup stock, meat and potato stew, spinach, and boiled beans. I'm proud of this section here. She points to the contents of the container. It does look good. If I remember correctly, no food or drink is allowed in the library. I think that's the same for most libraries. Never mind that. We should be in class right now.
Want some?
Look here. The one today isn't made of clay.
You usually eat lunches made of clay?
No, you'll get a tummy ache.
Do you want to eat clay?
I do not want to eat clay either.
You're not hungry?
I'm starting to get hungry.
Me too.
Our conversation isn't going anywhere and it almost seems like it's repeating itself. Hold on, Want some? She looks straight into my eyes and asks me again.
Want some?
There's a hint of loneliness in her voice. The breeze from the window floats across her childish hair a little bit. It makes me feel guilty for some reason. I am getting kinda hungry. I take a little bite. She nods with a sigh of relief. Let us eat. Let's eat. She puts her hands together in mouth. Say ah.
Hey, I can't do this. It's embarrassing. We just met.
Huh? She doesn't seem to understand what's embarrassing about it.
Jeez.
The way this girl is acting, it's unworldly. but I only have one pair of chopsticks. What should I do?
I pluck a piece of the stew and toss it into my mouth. I chew it thoroughly.
It's cold, but well seasoned.
Considering it's a handmade, I think she's a great cook.
Oh.
She's about to say something as she looks at my face again.
Good?
It's okay. She smiles faintly.
Once more?
I hear the lunch bell ring. In 15 minutes, this place will be crowded with students trying to study.
She doesn't have much in that lunchbox anyway. I can't bring myself to take more.
Sorry I bothered you.
After saying that, I turn my back to her.
I know she's hesitant. She's about to say something.
See you tomorrow.
That's all I hear.
I raise my left hand and answer before leaving the library.
And with that, I feel like that's a good stopping place for now.
Let's just save real quick, and then
we'll make a backup just in case.
Alrighty, have a nice day.